So, with Spider-Man No Way Home soon about to hit the cinemas, and with all the rumours at time of filming, by the time this comes out, all those rumours would have been cleared up, about what's happening in that film, I thought we'd go back and look at the first time a solo outing of number three happened. Let's look at, take a look at Spider-Man 3. Spider-Man 3 is a 2007 American superhero film based on the Marvel comics of the same name. The film's set about a year after the events of Spider-Man 2, and it follows Peter Parker as he prepares for his future with Mary J. Watson, facing three new villains: Flint Marko, aka the Sandman, his best friend Harry Osborn, and a more venomous creature. When the film was released, it received mixed reviews from the critics, who did praise the action sequences and visual effects, but they were polarised over the plot and pacing. So what have I found wrong with the film? Well, let's discuss 10 things wrong with Spider-Man 3. Number 10, avoidable injuries. When you make a film that is high action and things like that, it's inevitable that accidents will happen. And an accident did happen in this film with Thomas Haden Church. He broke his fingers punching a wall. Now, the thing about this accident, it was avoidable. The prop department was supposed to doctor the wall to make it punchable. However, they forgot to do it. So when he went to punch, thinking it's a propped wall that's going to break, the wall did nothing and broke his fingers. Not a good way to promote a film when your lead actors are breaking hands because your prop department doesn't do their jobs properly. Number 9. The film should have been split. Strange enough, I thought this one before the film came out and I watched the trailers, that the film should not have actually had Venom. It should have had the symbiote and the black suited Spider-Man. That bit was cool. But end the film on a cliffhanger with Eddie Brock turning into Venom. That means you can develop Venom that is so much more, just like they've done with the rebooted version of Venoms. But the fact that they've shown the evil Spider-Man, then spearheaded in Venom, it's too much crammed in. I know splitting films is now the norm nowadays, but back then it was a rarity. But this could have started the trend and really got the film going. But too much, split it over two films, it would have been a little bit better. Number 8, Uncle Ben's killer. Why did they do this? One of the praising points of Spider-Man 1 was its closeness to the source material. So what does this film do? It goes, changes the source material and retcons the first film, which was brilliant, by saying that Sandman, before he came Sandman, killed Uncle Ben. Why? Just to, you know, build some tension for Spider-Man? Yeah, it didn't work. It actually alienated comic book fans. It wasn't that good, no. Why did you do it? It's just wrong. Number 7, Willem Dafoe. Did you know Willem Dafoe was in this film? I'm being serious. Willem Dafoe is actually in this film, not as Norman Osborn, as an extra. So you've got this A-list celebrity as an extra. And what makes it even worse is it's not even very well hidden. At the jazz scene, when Gwen Stacy and Peter Parker sit in, they sit in front of a table, and that's Willem Dafoe sat behind them. The original Green Goblin, he sat behind them. Now, I know why he's done this. Sam Raimi does get high-profile actors as extras into his films. But if you're gonna do that, put them out the way so it's a blur or you don't see them. Not straight behind the main actress so you can see quite clearly who it is. It's very off-putting when you see that. Number 6, dating. I didn't get this at the time and it still bugs me now, but Eddie Brock was dating Gwen Stacy? No, that's never happened. A lot of this list is going to be how much wrong from the comics that this film got, but why do that? Like I said, one of the praise points from Spider-Man 1 and Spider-Man 2 was his faithfulness to the source material. So what do we do? Ruin it completely by putting a completely irrelevant love story. Gwen Stacy was Peter Parker's lover until Mary Jane Watson turned up and fans actually preferred her over Gwen Stacy, which is why she was written out and killed off. But putting her in a relationship with Eddie Brock? No, that doesn't work. Number 5, Venom's name. So in this film, what is the name of Venom? I'm being serious, what's his name? Yeah, they don't mention his name once, not once. They don't call him Venom. He is one of the most popular bad guys, anti-heroes out there, and you didn't even mention his name. The only clue, in a blink and you miss it, is when the symbiote first appears, jumps on the back of Peter Parker's bike, and it's in a V. Other than that, no mention whatsoever, at all. In fact, Venom actually called himself We Are Venom in his first appearance in Spider-Man. But no. Number 4, that dancing scene. Do I really need to say anything about this point? Really? I've got it in the Berry telly. That was just embarrassing. Yeah, moving on. Number 3, Venom size. Sorry to say this, but Venom's way too skinny. Way too skinny. In the comics, Eddie Brock bulked himself up so he could take on Peter Parker, then he merged with Venom. But so he was a big guy. Hell, even in the Venom, Sony's Venom series that they're doing, Venom is a big, bulky thing. But in this, he's not. He's not that big. He's not that bulky. He's quite slim and it doesn't work. Carnage is the slim one. Venom, big and bulky. Number 2, motivations. In a surprising climax to this film, Venom and Sandman team up. Why? No, seriously, why? Sandman's motivation all the way through this film is getting money for his daughter. Granted, he does it, try and do it in illegal means, but that's all he's after. So why, what benefits to him to team up with Venom to take out Spider-Man? Used a diversion, but it doesn't make sense. It changes the concept of the character. It changes the motivation of the character. All he wants is money. Venom didn't even offer him money. Let's just take out Spider-Man. No, you're right. I just want the money, mate. Seriously. Number 1, explosion. So right at the very end of this film, Venom is finally killed by an explosion. And I have quite a few things wrong with this explosion. First of all, when Peter Parker throws the grenade, Venom sort of latches onto it. Why does he do that? He knows it's something dangerous, everyone's cheering, he knows it's a weapon. Just make yourself go, the grenade goes through you, you're fine. But also, it was a big explosion. And I mean it was a big explosion. It actually puts all the pipes around it outwards. Yet Peter Parker, who stood right next to him, was undamaged. It vaporized Eddie Brock. And if you don't believe me, when you actually watch it, you see the skeleton of Eddie Brock. So it vaporized him. That's how powerful this explosion was. But standing next to it, now I'm absolutely fine. What the hell was going on with this film? It's like they didn't care. Final thoughts. Now, I know a lot of the issues is because Sam Raimi was not overly happy. He didn't want to do Venom. He was forced into doing this by the studio. And I think that's where the problem lies with this film. A lot of studio interference. And it shows. You've got the Green Goblin, which, to be fair, should have been the main villain of this film. It'd been building up since the first film. The relationship between Harry and Peter culminating in this film would have been brilliant. The Sandman, I actually don't mind the Sandman being in the film. It would have been a good, like, extra bad guy. Didn't need to add in that extra tension. You've got the tension between Harry and Peter. Why add it in again? I like the fact the black suit was in this film and having it change his personality. All of this would have worked perfectly, but you've added extra. Putting Venom in, like I said, cut the film and put that in the next one. Have it, or even if they didn't make the next one, what a brilliant way to end the film series. And that's the thing, they've tried to cram too much in to tie it up. One of the beautiful things about the first two films was it left seeds for future films. And that's what we liked, and we got that. But I don't think the Harry and Peter rivalry paid off in this film. It didn't work. Well, in my opinion, it didn't work. It was awful, it was rushed. The film seems to have dropped in quality as well. I know people praise it for its quality, but I think effects-wise, number two was the best of the three. The effects aren't that good. The Venom symbiont isn't that good. And I've said that it's better than the current Venom, the first Venom film that they released a few years ago. And the soundtrack doesn't have that killer soundtrack like the first film had. There's so much missing from this film that no wonder no one wanted to come back and do another one from it. Now, I do think they rushed too quickly and reboot it into The Amazing Spider-Man. I do think it did deserve having a fourth outing, because you've got this universe. It could have worked, it could have been repaired, but this film sort of mashed everything together and sort of ended everything. It was like not very good. But there are my opinions. Obviously, you at home have your own opinion, so let me know in the comments below. But what am I going to rate this film out of 10? I love Spider-Man. It's one of my favourite superheroes. My children love Spider-Man. It's one of their favourite superheroes. So this is going to hurt me, but I'm only going to give this a 4. A 4 out of 10 berries. Maybe I'm being a bit harsh. I don't know. Possibly. Let me know in the comments below. On to next week, we're going to start doing our Christmas videos, getting into the Christmas spirit. So come back with your joy time feelings. Take care. Bye-bye.